mean, I'm never going to say to anyone that there's not going to be negative fallout for everyone in the family of going through the divorce process. It is a difficult process, even the most amicable. But happy, healthy parents, even if they're in two households, will have happy, healthy children.
I'm Summer.
And I'm Mike.
And we got married with children.
It's been 12 years since we got this gang together.
And we're still running the rapids of living with a blended family.
And sometimes that is just not easy.
If you're looking for support and tools when it comes to divorce, step-parenting, co-parenting, and giving it your best,
you're in the right place.
We're talking about everything.
You ready to get this party started?
Always.
Hello, listeners. Welcome to another episode of Everything Always. Today, we have a super fantastic, awesome guest on the show. And I'm really excited because I've gotten to spend time with her a few times. Actually, I got to be a guest on her podcast, and I actually got to do a live with her with the authors of Our Happy Divorce. So if you've listened to the podcast, if you remember the episode where we talked with Nikki and Ben, they were the couple that had the divorce that kind of rocky in the beginning, but then had this amazing, the way that they've done it has just been amazing. And now they're all friends, the co-parents, the new spouses. Anyways, they do this live where they have different experts on the show. And Susan, my guest today, is a part of that. So my guest is Susan Guthrie today. And she is recognized as one of the top family law and mediation attorneys in the country. And this is like over 30 years she's been doing this. And she's been helping individuals and families really navigate divorce and separation and co-parenting and all the stuff that comes along with getting a divorce when you have children. And she also provides online divorce mediation and legal coaching to clients around the world. She's amazing. And I was so excited to have her on the show just because of, I mean, her credentials are insanely awesome. She's got a huge podcast herself, which is called The Divorce and Beyond Podcast. And it's like, I'm pretty sure it's listed as the top podcast for self-help podcasts, especially related to divorce. So you have to check it out. I think I talk about it in the actual episode of how many downloads and people she has listening to it. It's crazy, but she's amazing. She's just so awesome. And today we're talking about all of the stuff and how you can avoid even going to court as a divorce couple. And, you know, what are the things that you can do to not have to spend tons and tons of money and do the right thing for your kids? So all of these things we're discussing. I also want to make sure that you listen out for the community of hers that you can be a part of and listen out for what she has as a giveaway. So we're talking about all of that, but you've got to listen to the podcast to take advantage of that. Before we begin, I've promised you guys some open letters that we have been receiving, which is awesome. Thank you guys so much. I'm really proud of the stuff that you guys are sending in. I'd love to see more. I got to be honest, I'd love to see even more of these letters because they're so, so good. And I feel it. I feel like every single one of them I relate to. And again, if this is your first time listening, what am I talking about? These open letters are an opportunity for you to write a letter to someone, but never give it to them. And so it's a forum where you can vent some things that you just want to say, whether it's to a broad audience, whether it's to a specific person, but it's 100% anonymous. So if you go to everythingalways.co and you go to forum, you can submit your letter to anyone you wish. We will receive it and we are reading these letters. We're reading at least one on each episode. and it's totally anonymous. We don't know who you are. We have no information whatsoever. It comes to us and that's it. We read it. So it's kind of like this cathartic feeling of it getting out there without anyone knowing who you are. So here's today's. Dear friend, you probably don't remember me. We were friends in high school, though not very good. We each married and moved to different cities, and we are friends on Facebook, but still you don't keep in touch. I don't think you ever like a post of mine. Well, I don't post often. This letter isn't about that, though. This letter is about what I see you doing online, and I wanted to anonymously offer my 2 cents for what it's worth. In high school, you were always nice to me, even when others would make fun of me. I wasn't very popular, but you would send a smile my way or even talk to me during breaks. It made me feel special, and you may never know that. This letter isn't about that either. Well, not really. See, I got married and you got married. You got divorced and I also got divorced. I loved watching you with your kids and you seemed to be a very loving mom and have a great family. But somewhere along the way you changed. The things you post about other people, your ex and his family in particular, made me change my opinion on you. It really disappointed me because I looked up to how strong you were. The reason it really bothers me is that I've been the recipient of such posts. I got divorced and I got remarried and my husband's girlfriend has done what you do. She posts things that are untrue on her social media about my husband. It affects me, him, and his kids. His kids are teens now and they see this. They also had mutual friends and they see this. We've asked her to stop when we found out, but she hasn't. She said it's her right to do this. Maybe it is. Maybe it's not mature in our eyes. My ex-husband would never do that to me, and we've agreed that no matter what happened between us, we would never go to that low level, and I'm proud to say that neither of us have. We only have one son, and I'm sure it wouldn't be a good thing for either of us to display such immaturity online. You're not the only one I see do these things, but it really upsets me when you start doing it because I didn't expect it from you. This open letter is to you and to those doing what you're doing. It makes you look bad, and I know you're not. I know you get hurt like many of us do, but it makes you look like the opposite of the really good person I know you are. Your kids are too good for it too. That's all, and thanks for reading. Well, thank you so much for that, and I was really excited actually when I got this particular letter because I have seen this before and I've thought some similar things where I've wondered what is the intention and I'm guessing it's a vent for someone to say negative things or to say the things that they're feeling and to get some support back, which I understand, but I also appreciate this insight as to how it can affect other people and more importantly, how it can probably affect your own image. Gosh, I remember years ago when I saw this happen to someone that we really loved who was posting something negatively about a person's mother. And I thought, oh no, this is so bad because your daughter's a young adult and she's going to see all this. So, I appreciate this and I'm really glad to have read this because I hope that people are thinking about what their actions are and how it makes them look, how it really affects the other people that are involved, and to really think about that before you go out and post something. So thank you again so much for posting this and I hope it impacts somebody. And with that, let's get into the interview with Susan Guthrie.
Susan, welcome to the show. And thank you so much for being with me today.
Oh, Summer, I'm so excited to be here. Thank you very much for having me.
Well, we've gotten to connect a few times. We had our Happy Divorce authors on our podcast a couple of months ago, and that's how you and I met, and they're amazing. And I'm just so grateful that I got to got to meet you and connect with you because you have such a cool story. And I know you're going to give really, really solid advice and value for our listeners. So let's talk about your story and how you got into what your personal dynamic is in your family and your blended family, and then how you got into the line of work that you do.
Yeah. And they kind of intertwined quite a bit considering what I do and what I've lived through. Right. So it's, yeah, it's an interesting conversation.
Totally. So what's your dynamic in your family?
So I am the bonus mom. So I was married and divorced, but my former husband and I did not have children. We just fought over our Yorkies. And then I met my current husband, who at the time I met him had 5-year-old triplets. And he was just finishing a rather contentious divorce. So I went from, you know, single woman to girlfriend, then stepmom of 5-year-old triplets. They were 12-year-olds when we got married, and they're now about a week or two away from being 23-year-olds. So it's been a number of years that they've been a part of my journey.
Yes. Oh my gosh. That's, and triplets too. Wow.
Yes. It was, you know, it was, my favorite part was I was 44 when my husband and I got married, and we had been together for like 6 or 7 years. And everyone, when we got married, everyone was like, "So are you guys going to have kids now?" And I'm like, "Triplets? Hello, everyone." I'm, you know, not to mention 44. So we did not have that chance to have kids ourselves. But trust me, 3 12-year-olds, 3 5-year-olds, 3 23-year-olds, I feel like I have kids. So.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And what is your relationship like with them?
You know, I would say I have a really good relationship with my stepkids now. It's had its ups and downs. It was a difficult transition, which is one of the reasons why I know you guys waited a while before you got married.
Yes.
But we're together. Yeah, we had that same situation where the dynamic just never felt right to do that. And then, you know, when we finally did get married, it actually made everything that much better. It actually calmed everything down. I think there was something about the formality of going through the ceremony and the having the same last name or, you know, it made everything better. And it's all been, you know, on a positive uphill journey since then.
Yeah. Oh, I so know the journey and I know all of those feelings. Yeah. So were you an attorney at the time that you guys met, or did that happen afterwards?
You know, so I was a divorce attorney. That's all I've ever really done. So I was a divorce attorney when I went through my first divorce, and I was a litigator at that time. I handled it from a very, you know, adversarial approach. And it was when I met David, and he was going through a higher conflict divorce. And then I was seeing the effects with the kids and, you know, just what the whole adversarial approach looked like from the inside. It was really at that time when I found that the adversarial and litigation approach didn't work for me. And that's really when I started to transition over to mediation as the approach for divorce. So really my personal life very much colored my professional life. And I sort of never looked back. I switched over to a mediation approach to divorce. Now I train other mediators how to be mediators. And it's pretty much my mission in life to help people have a more positive experience of divorce than a litigation approach allows.
And that's what we're going to talk about today, which is going to be so, so good. Because, you know, you talk about how those choices that you make at the beginning of your divorce is just so important, because they're going to have long lasting consequences with the kids and with your partner. What are the big problems and struggles that you see in that early phase when couples are no longer couples, but they're heated up and they're emotional and there's kids involved? What are the things that you see that you're like, no, don't do it that way?
Yeah, it's such a great question, because it's such a common situation, you know, where people have decided after, you know, all the things that happen in a marriage that it comes to the point of divorce. It's such an emotional time. And in that moment of emotion, when there's usually, you know, anger or hurt or, you know, some high level of emotion, that is when people usually run right out and hire an attorney. And their decisions in that moment in time are often colored by the high emotion. And unfortunately, when you start your divorce, you know, by hiring, as our friend Ben from Our Happy Divorce will say, his first instinct was to hire the shark attorney who was going to, you know, make life difficult and make everything the fault of Nikki, of the former spouse. And unfortunately, when you make that choice in the beginning, even if you then your emotions come down or you calm down, which is hard to do when you've started your divorce out with the shark, it's very hard to pull back from that. Yeah. And so once you start going down that knee-jerk reaction, adversarial approach, you've now colored not only your divorce process, but frankly, when you approach it that way, you're going to color the rest of your co-parenting life together and your post-divorce relationship in almost all circumstances is going to be worse because there's nothing about the adversity of litigation that will make it easy for you to co-parent happily or easily or even with a degree of cooperation because that's not what it's based on.
Right. And I'm sure you've seen it firsthand how it affects children. And I'm sure it's a little bit different for different ages, but we need to talk about that because if it's one thing, you know, that I'm super passionate about is how the problems between the parents affect the kids and it's so unnecessary.
Yeah. You know, and it's so true what you're saying and the thing that parents have to understand, and I've said this so many times, you know, through my career, but it's, I know this to be true. I've done this for more than 30 years. It is not the divorce itself that causes difficulty for your children. It is the level of conflict between their parents that causes problems for children, that children have a hard time coming back from, and that is the biggest predictor of them having issues in their lives. And it does not matter if you're arguing over them or if you're arguing over whether today is Thursday, it is the fact that you are in conflict. And for those parents, somebody just said this to me the other day. Well, sure, we fight all the time, but we don't do it in front of the kids. They don't know. And, you know, I don't want to laugh because it's not funny, but the fact that parents think that they can go lock themselves in a room, scream at each other, and then come back out and their kids don't know that something is going on in the household. It's unfortunate. It's sad because trust me, your children know. Children know what is going on in their household. And there's something that's actually worse about the fact that parents might come out and put on a false happy face rather than actually addressing the emotions. So, you know, there is so much about how mom and dad or mom and dad experience their divorce that then trickles down to the children that, again, it's so important that parents try for the sake of their children to at least have a respectful divorce, to treat their soon to be ex with respect and some courtesies and hopefully receive that back because that's what's going to be the most helpful to their children.
That is so true. And I think it gives hope too for people that stay in a relationship that might not be good and would probably be better apart for the children. But I think people worry about, well, no, that will cause so much stress for the kids. And really, like you said, what causes the stress is the conflict. And I love that you said, you know, you're fighting behind closed doors and they don't know. We're all intuitive beings. Like we just have that gut feeling. You can tell when somebody is faking a smile or like you pick your child up from school or when you used to be able to do that. And, yeah. And you, You have like, you know, you could just feel the they didn't have a good day. You know, you just know as much as they'll try to hide it. So I love that you said that because it really does. It comes down to how we handle something rather than looking at it as this is just happening to our family and that's what the stress is.
Yeah. I mean, it's there. And the other thing parents need to take into consideration, you mentioned the parents who stay maybe in a marriage thinking, well, I don't want to put my children through the stress of a divorce. You know, there's also a consideration that I think we need to take it, you know, into our thought process of what are we modeling for our children? And what do we want for them as they go forward into the world? And if what we show them is that an unhappy marriage is an okay place to be, is all right to stay in, or that parents who are chilly with each other or who argue or who just don't pay any attention to each other, you know, we have to realize everything that we do, including how do we conduct ourselves through our divorce, is something that the little people in our lives are watching and learning from.
Yes, absolutely. We are that example for them. I notice that a lot when I see parents who aren't getting along and the behavior that they will display, whether it's in front of the children or it's just to, even just to their friends, the bad mouthing that they're doing to other parents, or it's on social media. Sometimes they're venting what they're upset about. And I'm like, oh my goodness. Like one of the first rules we try to teach our children, especially when they were starting with social media, is be kind, don't gossip, don't talk about other people and all of those things. And then those parents are doing just that. And it's, you know, you look at it and you go, well, you're modeling a behavior that your children will see. And now that's how they think it's okay to respond to something or react to something.
Right. Well, we've lost our filter, right? We've started to put, you know, things out on social media that we wouldn't say to people's faces, that we're given some sort of a distance by fact that it were through a screen, but we forget that that's out there for the entire world, yeah, including our children. And, you know, children they just know. They know what's happening. They know when their parents are happy and they know when their parents are unhappy. And I've always said, yes, I mean, I'm never going to say to anyone that there's not going to be negative fallout for everyone in the family of going through the divorce process. It is a difficult process, mm-hmm, even the most amicable, but happy, healthy parents, even if they're in two households, will have happy, healthy children. Yes. And there are ways you can still raise happy, healthy children, even if you are co-parenting with someone who won't cooperate with you or who is high conflict. I mean, all you can do is what you can do, but having yourself be a healthy person, being in a good place is the best you can do for your children.
And what are your suggestions for those type that don't have a parent that cooperates with them? They're completely opposite when it comes to co-parenting and what their views are.
Yeah. And unfortunately that, you know, right, that happens in intact marriages and is amplified in divorces. You know, the thing that causes the biggest problem with high conflict exes is that the person who is dealing with the high conflict person continues to believe that in some way they can rationalize with that person and effectuate change in their behaviors. And that is not likely to ever happen. In fact, if you're dealing with, you know, a narcissist or someone who is personality disordered, it's not possible. The only person that you can affect change with that you can control is yourself. So in that paradigm, all you can do is control how you react to their high conflict antics. And for most of that, it should be just you get an email from them that is full of their, you know, vituperative comments or, you know, allegations that you're a poor parent or you did this or you did that. you just acknowledge what needs to be acknowledged, ignore the rest, and move forward. It's the 10-page email that you send back that tries to tell them, well, studies have shown if you would just spend more time and be a better parent, that our children would do better. You're not going to change them. You can only change yourself. So it's hard for people. It's the hardest thing I see for people is they're, because that what they have to give up on is this idea that they're going to have a good co-parenting relationship and that their children aren't going to have two parents that can co-parent well together. And sometimes, and it's not your fault, but sometimes it's not going to be possible. The best you can do is do what you can do in your household and to manage how you deal with your high conflict spouse.
Yeah, I love that so much. And we're, Mike and I say that all the time because there are situations where you feel completely out of control because you are trying to control somebody else and the way that they are handling something and you just can't. And I think, again, going back to being an example, if you can show that, you know, you are in control of your own emotions and you make choices as to how you react to something instead of just your gut reaction, it just shows such a high level of maturity that your kids will model. And because yep. that's what they're seeing. And they'll clearly see the difference of the parent that might not be doing that. And so then they get to make the choice of, well, what tends to get a better response? What seems to be a better feeling afterwards when I act out of control and get mad and slam things? Or if I'm calm and I, you know, try to deal with this in a really, like, in a way that's actually going to move some type of needle forward instead of cause more chaos and stress.
Yeah. Well, and with high conflict parents, you have to remember your children are going to deal with the high conflict aspects of their parent as well. So if you can help them model that, can, you know, you can control how you act or you react to the high conflict behaviors of the other parent, you actually can help your child manage their relationship with their high conflict parent as well. Because unfortunately, you know, with people who have with personality disorders, it can rise to the level where it affects all of their relationships, not just their relationship with you, their ex-spouse. So you can help your children in that way as well by modeling the best way to manage that difficult relationship.
Yes, definitely. You know, I'm curious as we're talking about this, because we'll talk a lot. We started this talking about what you do at the beginning of a divorce, but how often did you deal with couples that had been divorced for years and came back to a legal situation or found themselves in court or some type of mediation again?
I mean, when I was a litigator, that's the norm. And it goes back to what I was saying earlier is when you go through a conflictual divorce, you're just setting up a system of, you know, systematized ongoing conflict, because the minute the divorce is over, something else will come up and you come right back into court to litigate that, because that's what you've learned how to do. That's how you deal with your ex. Now you take them back to court. So it's very much a part of the paradigm. It's when people are able to sit down and actually work together to come up with agreements, like in a mediation setting or in a collaborative divorce setting, where the participants are actually a part of the decision-making process and the negotiation process. Those agreements tend to be longer lasting, and those people are much more able to just work things out amongst themselves without having to come back into the court system or back into their lawyer's office to work through the issues for them.
Yeah. Have you ever wanted to send an anonymous message or letter to someone? For me, the most powerful therapy has always been to write. If I feel angry, sad, super inspired, or just wanting to feel understood, I write, and often I write letters to someone when those feelings involve a particular person. When it comes to divorce, co-parenting, step-parenting, new relationships, and everything that comes along with blended families, there tends to be a lot we don't say and a lot we wish we could say. And it feels so good writing a letter as if
you are going to send it to that person. It's like this huge pressure off of your chest. It's kind of cathartic. Well, we want to offer you that forum where you can have a voice. Anonymously, of course. If there's something you've always wanted to say to someone, but knew that out of respect or to save drama or because you knew it wouldn't be received well, now is your chance to get it out there and have it be read, because we would like to serve as your voice. So here's what to do. Head over to everythingalways.co/forum. That's FORUM, everythingalways.co/forum, and fill out the form. We won't know who you are, as it will be sent to us totally anonymously. It just hits our inbox, but we have no idea who it's coming from. As they come in, we will be sharing these on the podcast. We'll be able to reply to you. You'll still remain anonymous unless you reply back. And we'll let you know if it will be featured. It's 100% confidential. So what do you say? Ready to get it off your chest? Okay, back to the episode.
And that was a big thing that I really wanted to talk to you about, is what are the things that people can do to stay out of court, or just to have a collaborative, like you said, mediation? What are the things that they, tools and tips? And I know there's a lot of, you've got to work on yourself, but what are some things that they can walk away with and go, okay, I'm about to go into, this situation. I don't want to be in this icky situation with my ex anymore. I don't want to have the cycle of going to court. I don't want to jump at every time something goes wrong, I'm going to take you to court. Like, what, for those people that are listening that find themselves in this cyclical conflict, what are things that they can do to be in a more collaborative state?
So one of the things is to try and get it out of that litigation model. Things like mediation or a collaborative post-dissolution process, those are always available to people. It is harder once you're caught up in the litigation cycle to move out of it, but you always can. You always can choose to go to mediation or go to a different process to try to work things through. And the way to, mediation is 100% voluntary. Both parties have to decide to go to mediation. But what you have to do if you want to get your ex now to go to mediation is think about, what about the mediation process will appeal to them? You have to, it's just like any negotiation, right? You have to think about what incentivizes the other side. People always think about why they want to do something, and they think that's going to motivate the other side. And frankly, that's the last thing that's probably going to motivate the other person, even if it's something they want. If they know you want it, in that adversarial mindset, that's the last thing they want to give you. But there are many, many benefits, say, to mediation. It's less expensive. It's less time consuming. It's less adversarial. It's faster. It requires less, court visits, et cetera. Think about the person that you're dealing with and approach them with the aspects of the process that will appeal to them. And I will say, the less expense is usually one of the big ones, especially once you've been through the conflict cycle a few times through litigation. You have now written some pretty big attorney fee checks along the way. There's no way to get through a litigation cycle without paying a lot of money. It's an expensive concept or process. So even post-dissolution, post the divorce, you can often get your spouse to consider, your ex-spouse to consider mediation, because it's going to be a lot less expensive.
Right, right.
And during COVID, it's one of the only games in town too. Courts are generally not open to hear your post, dissolution conflict issues right now in many cases. So if you have things that need to be resolved, mediation is another, that's another reason why your spouse, my ex-spouse might be willing to go and work the issues out at a mediation table.
Yeah, definitely. And I've actually seen couples that have done that through Zoom. So they're there and they're making it happen.
Yeah. I've been mediating online for 5 years. And we'll never go back to doing it in person. There's a lot of benefits actually to doing it online. One of which is you don't have to sit in the same room with the person that you're having this discussion yes. with. So it's less emotional, and that makes it easier for people to talk about these things. So it's actually a very beneficial aspect of mediation is to do it online.
That is such a good point. I never thought of that. Yeah. I'm wondering after this, how many people will just stay, you know, and keep it that way. You know, it is so much easier to, you just feel more comfortable too in your own home setting than in this exactly. room where there could be other people. It's awkward.
Oh, and you just sat in traffic for an hour to get to the mediator's office. You're sitting in some stranger's, you know, space talking about your personal stuff. Most of my clients, when I'm doing mediations online, are sitting on their couch with their dog. I mean, if you have to talk about a difficult thing, I'd want to be sitting on my couch with my dogs.
Totally. Know? Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I want to talk about divorce, because this is just a few of things that we're dropping to our audience that I think is going to be so helpful. But I also know that you have created this whole community, Divorce in a Better Way, and you have tons of resources. And I'd love to share, you know, what it is that you do there and what people can gain by going there.
Yeah, you know, my whole goal and my whole point of what I do at this point in my career is to try to let people know that adversarial model is not the only way to go through divorce, and it's not the most successful way to go through it. That's why the name of the website is Divorce in a Better Way. There are many better ways to do it. And so what I've created on the website are a number of different resources for all different stages of divorce and information based on my 30 plus years of doing this to try and give people information and some educational content to help them move through it in a more positive way. Because I've seen it all. I have seen the worst of nasty drag out custody battles that have gone on for years in court and cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, all the way to couples who have, you know, we've group hugged at the end of their mediation process and they've gone to court for the final hearing in the same car and gone out to lunch together. I mean, I've had the Wow. full spectrum. And so I know it's possible to have, you know, a happy divorce or a good divorce or a more positive divorce, or to have it be a restructuring of your family that, while difficult, will help you all get to a better place. And yes. that's, you know, I try to bring and partner with other professionals in our world who can bring that kind of information to people. And so that website is just really there for me to bring. I'm lucky because I get to meet a lot of great people who do what we do and are in this, you know, space trying to help people through this. And so I just want to share as much of that as I can.
I love it so much. You've been featured everywhere. I've talked about it in the intro. Your podcast is huge. I think you're at over 4 million listens, if I'm correct.
Yeah.
It's so cool. But I mean, there's just such a need for it. Let's actually talk. I got to be on the podcast, which that was a blast. And I want to talk about, you know, what are some of the things that you're talking about on that podcast? What are the hardcore issues that you're helping people with?
Yeah, that podcast is really, it's Divorce and Beyond. And I picked that name very purposefully because one of the things that I've noticed as a divorce professional for so many years is that for many people, the divorce becomes all consuming and it essentially grows to these proportions where it takes over their life. And for a very unfortunate but significant portion of people, it continues to color their lives beyond, right? It never goes away. There's something about the trauma of the experience that continues on beyond that. And what I really want to help people to understand, and so the topics I try to cover on the podcast are, yes, the divorce is difficult. Here's information to help you get through that aspect of it. But really, the beyond is where your life is. And so I bring as many experts on and people to talk about how they have successfully navigated that beyond, how they've made a new life and a better future for themselves and for their families in the world beyond divorce.
Yes, that is, that's like you said, that's the, I mean, it is all hard, but there is that, there's the beyond part when it comes to the new life that you're creating, new relationship for many people, new family members, if you've got a blended family. Yep. And sometimes it's the beginning of a new career for a lot of people. You know, they were doing something, maybe they were doing something with their husband or wife beforehand, whatever it was. And now it's something all new, or maybe they were a stay-at-home parent and now they're, you know, there's so many different things. And I know you talk about that too, which is using your divorce as an opportunity to create a better future instead of being doom and gloom as, oh no, I've failed and that's it. Now I'm going to be this old person with cats crawling all over me.
It's all over. My life is done. But, yeah, right. I talk to people. Unfortunately, I just had a conversation the other day with somebody at a virtual happy hour, right? People find out you're a divorce attorney and they're like, oh, I've got to tell you about my divorce. It's kind of like the doctor and my elbow hurts. But I was talking to a woman and she was telling me the story of her divorce and she was calling her ex-husband's, who it turns out new wife, the whore. And, you know, she was very emotionally invested and very negative in the entire discussion. Well, it turns out that divorce had happened 20 years ago. And the whore, the person she was referring to, had been her ex-husband's wife for 18 plus years. And she was still living it. She was telling me the story and she was in it. And for me, the person I was sad for in all of that was the woman I was talking to, because she never moved into the beyond. She's still living a life of that moment of the divorce. And, you know, people, you just said that divorce is an opportunity, and it's an opportunity where the future that we thought we had is now not there, right? There's going to be a major change. And many people will focus on that abyss as if it were this dark thing out into the future and the unknown. And instead, I encourage people to think of it as one of those few times in life where we have the opportunity to really look inside to what motivates us, what our values are, what we're passionate about, and create a new future with some freedom. It may not be complete freedom. We're not, you know, unencumbered. We may have relationships and family and children and things that keep us where we are. So maybe you can't move to Tibet, but you can start to move your life in a direction with different priorities and different values at the forefront. And that is an opportunity that many people don't take advantage of because they're unable to see it. And so that's definitely a message of my podcast that I really try to get across to people.
Yeah, it's so empowering just to hear, especially if you start to just visualize yourself in the future and what the possibilities are. Just that alone can get you excited instead of always living in the past of what happened and who did what to who. That doesn't get you anywhere. I mean,
going back. You're not going to change history. So focusing on it isn't going to change anything.
Exactly. I mean, its only purpose is really to learn from it. And then once you do learn from it, it's so easy to let go because now it's served its purpose.
Yep. Yeah. You know, the thing that happens, and this is another reason why I'm not a fan of the litigation process, is because litigation and legal process, I mean, what it is really just any other lawsuit. It's taking the facts of what happened. So in this case, it's the facts of your broken marriage and applying the law to those facts to try and get what you want, right? That is what litigation is. That's what they teach us in law school. find the facts in these people's history, apply the law to those facts or those facts to the law to get what your client wants. So what is it? It's focused on this negative past, as opposed to a process like mediation, where it's coming at it from a problem solving aspect of how do we move this family forward in the best way that we can so that they can go forward. And it's not focused. In fact, I try to keep people from being too focused on who did what, because as we just said, you can't change the things that have gone on in the past. You can, I love that you said you can learn from them, but you can't change them. And you need to let them go so that you can move forward and create that new future for yourself.
Absolutely. You know, you're reminding me of a story of there's someone in my family, I won't call out names, but someone in my family who married a man, and it's, and they've probably, I want to say it's over 15 years, and he had an ex-wife and kids. And it was literally like the 15 years later that they need to have this whole meeting together with his ex-wife's new husband, not new husband. She'd been married to him for all those years too. And they come together. I guess the divorce was probably like, I don't know, 17 years or something. And they've been married for 15 years, and they all have to sit down because she's upset about something. And what ends up coming out, they were supposed to talk about their child together. And what ends up coming out is all of this anger, resentment that the ex-wife had held in for all of those years. And she's unleashing it all in front of her current husband and in front of her ex-husband's wife. And it was like this whole thing. And I remember talking to this woman in my family, and she was just like, it was the craziest thing ever, you know, that all of these years, none of that had been let go. And now the current husband clearly sees that. You know, it's just like, oh my gosh, how awful, you know, to hold on for so long to all of that anger and resentment, and how it keeps you so stuck and unable to move forward to all these amazing possibilities.
Yeah. Well, and think how sad that is for every single person who was in that conversation. Her new, I'm going to, you know, in quotes, her new husband, who's hearing that his wife has been mired in this emotional content from her first marriage for their entire marriage, and her ex, I mean, it's just for the children involved or child involved. That is exactly the situation that I'm talking about, because the person, they all lost there, but that I feel sorry for that woman, because there's two elements of it. She's not dealt with her feelings about what happened. She also hasn't probably dealt with her role in what happened. And that is the other thing that so often will hold people back. If you cannot own your own side of the street and make this all about being a victim, then you are going to be your own victim. Unfortunately, you are going to be, because that's maybe another element of what was happening there. People are like, I was done wrong. I didn't get justice. And they get very wedded to that position. And unfortunately, that will hold you back as well.
That is so true. And I say this all the time. I say this in business and personal life. Taking responsibility gives you such freedom when you can own the things that you messed up on or where you feel like you failed. Just take responsibility for what you're unhappy about, because that's probably the hardest thing for people to do, is own their role in something. And yet once you do, it's the most freeing feeling.
You have to acknowledge it. You have to own it. And then you know what you have to do? You have to forgive yourself. Mm-hmm. And that is how you move on. That's like, we just outlined the formula for moving on or letting go. And, you know, it's what I see, you know, and I guarantee the woman who was telling me the story at the virtual happy hour about her, you know, her ex-husband and his new wife of 18 years, you know, marriages don't generally break down all because of one person. I mean, there's usually some joint culpability or whatever you want to call it, or maybe it wasn't a relationship that was viable at any point anyway. But you have to deal with both sides of it, and you have to deal with it, or you will be sitting there at a dining room table with your new husband and your ex-spouse and their new spouse having that conversation that your family member had, which to me is one of the saddest situations out there. People whose lives, I mean, that's 18 years people don't get back.
Yeah, exactly. Wow. Oh my gosh, we've talked about so many good things, and I hope that our listeners are having revelations, whether it's, you know, something that you need to recognize yourself and own, or just wherever you're at in a divorce situation or a co-parenting situation, is to really think about, you know, how can you be in a more collaborative state rather than nitpicking and being in that conflict state, really. And just really how it affects the kids. And you have I know you have if I'm remembering correctly, I think you have a link to a really good film on your website that talks about the effects of divorce and how it impacts the kids, which I think is a really great wake-up call for a lot of people to see how their actions affect them that they might not even realize is affecting their children.
Yeah, the website, the film is called Split. And it's a documentary that Ellen Bruno did. She's a documentarian, actually. She normally does films like about genocide and sex trafficking and all this. But she did a film 6-7 years ago where she interviewed children. And the entire film is 6 and 7 year olds, 11 year olds. They were younger children. It's just them. All you see on the screen is the children. And in their voices, they're talking about their experience of their parents' divorce. And I will tell you, you know, I, as I've mentioned, I've been doing this for a long time. I've heard a lot, but the voices of the children are not what we attorneys hear, right? We don't meet with the children. We don't bring them into courtrooms for obvious reasons.
Right.
It's gut-wrenching to hear the impact of our behavior on the children. And if you want to try to get your spouse or your ex-spouse to maybe modify some of their behavior, the film is a good way to do that because it does allow people to take a look at how their actions affect their children.
Yeah. And I would also add in advise it as something, hey, I was thinking we should both watch this. So it's not you telling somebody else what to do.
Yeah. Very, very, very true. Because you know what? They won't watch it. Don't use it. As I said earlier, if you think you're going to change them with like statistics or studies about, you know, co-parenting, that's not it. But it is a fantastic, what we actually suggest is parents watch it together is ideal. And then watch it with their children because it allows children to connect with what the film was actually made for children to watch. And it's turned into a tool that's helpful to everyone. And even, you know, they show it in schools for kids in intact families as well as divorced families, because it allows other children to understand what their friends are going through when their parents, you know, when their parents are divorcing. So it may not even be that the children that are watching it or the people that it helps are just the families that are divorcing. It's all families can benefit from this film.
Yeah. And I would imagine too, we know ourselves when we watch something and somebody is speaking, you know, where you feel that connection because they're speaking your voice in a way. So I'm sure these kids are watching this and sometimes they maybe don't know how to express it, but they see another child saying it and they're like, yeah, that's how I feel too. And it kind of gives them permission to say it out loud.
Yeah, it's exactly that. And it's, you know, it's even more so because children try to protect us. They're adults, right? They don't want to hurt our feelings or they don't want to say something that might upset us. But when they can say, well, what that kid said in the film, or they can associate it with something that's not talking about us, it makes it easier for them because our kids do try to protect us, right?
Yeah, so true. Well, you can find that film on Susan's website, which is divorceinabetterway.com. And everything that we're talking about today, I will have links in the show notes to all of these things, to the podcast, which is Divorce and Beyond. And you have something new out with the podcast, am I right?
Yes, I'm just launching a members only aspect of the podcast, which is for members, for people who want to join as members. It's only $10 a month, and it's going to have a lot of additional resources. It's going to have extra podcast episodes that are just me talking about a lot of the legal aspects and advice about divorce. I have a lot of my experts coming who are doing special Ask the Expert Anything, and I'll be doing some Ask Susan Anythings. I have a lot of downloadable resources and worksheets and all of that. So if anybody's interested in that, it's on the divorceandbeyondpod.com website. And I will send you a link. And if any of your listeners would like to sign up on the link, I'll do a drawing, and one person will win a free year's membership.
Awesome. I love it. I love that. So great. Well, yeah. this has been so awesome for so many reasons. Really talking to people at any stage of divorce, even if you're just in that place where you're thinking about it. And we actually do get a lot of listeners that start listening to the podcast. They're not in a blended family yet, but their mind is going down that road because they're like, that could be my future because things mm-hmm. aren't going well. And they foresee, they're in a separation, or they foresee a divorce happening. And so these are things that they're thinking about because, they're at an age where they think the person they meet is probably going to have some kids, or they may have been divorced as well. And they know that, stuff comes along with that. So this is just really so helpful, no matter where you're at in your journey. But I think the biggest takeaway for me is really looking at the divorce that has happened or is happening, whatever is happening that you feel is a negative thing, it's actually an opportunity for you. And if you always have that mindset, you will be turning it into an opportunity without realizing it.
Yeah, I love that. That is exactly, if I have one overriding message, and I can tell people who are listening that the number one thing I hear from anyone that I've, been through the divorce with them, whether they've been a mediation client or a litigation client or someone I've helped coach, when I talk to them years down the road, to the number, every single one of them has said in the end, the divorce was a positive thing for their lives, that their lives are better and that the direction of their lives has been better since they were able to move beyond that relationship. And you will. It is better. You need to get through the process, but life is better on the other side.
Susan, thank you so, so much. This is so great.
Oh, Summer, thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much for listening. And we like to say, if you enjoyed this episode, share it with someone you love, and be bold enough to share it with someone you don't. See you next time.